All right, what's up, guys? It's Kostov here, and today I'm going to be telling you about my first real job. And I'm not talking about my first real job like in high school where I went and worked like some weekends at like the Atlanta Bread Company, because I had like a few jobs growing up. I worked at like Pizza Hut. I did a lot of under the table work during the summers for my friend's pressure washing business. But no, today I'm going to tell you about my first real job like after school. Now, I've mentioned it a few times, but most of you guys know that I got a bachelor's in accounting, and then after that I went to law school and got my Juris Doctorate. And a lot of people have commented, you know, why aren't you practicing law? And a lot of them just assume that I became a YouTuber and just got kind of caught up in all this stuff, and that I'd actually set out to be a YouTuber and just went and got my degree for, I don't know, whatever reason. But that's not actually the truth. What actually happened is I just fell into this industry. Now, I'm going to start this story back when I'm still in law school, because back in law school, I met this guy named Brandon. He eventually became my roommate in school, and he went to my law school, and he introduced me to this game called Call of Duty. Now, before we lived together as roommates, I used to like go over to his house, and we would play zombies all night, and we would literally spend like an entire night getting to level 50 on Darice, like back in WoW. And that same year, Modern Warfare 2 came out, so I just generally started playing Call of Duty, and this was the first time I'd ever really played first-person shooters. Now, I grew up gaming, but I always played like single-player games, a lot of sports games, and although I didn't really play a lot of online multiplayer, because that wasn't really a huge thing yet when I was in school, or if it was, I wasn't really into it. Like, Halo was like the main multiplayer game, I guess, on console back then, but I'd never really gotten into it. But I was like in college this whole time, or in school, so I had played multiplayer, but just like locally a lot. So like in the dorm rooms, we play PGA golf and the fight night game, and we'd always play Halo like just in multiplayer, like locally, and with a huge split screen, so we'd all be screen watching and shit like that. But the real birth of my gaming addiction was right then and there when I learned how to play zombies and started playing Call of Duty, and eventually got my own Xbox and my own headset, and just really started to fall into playing. And eventually I met this guy named Corey, and he was just like really good at Call of Duty, and all he did was go into these lobbies and talk mad shit whenever he would do well, and then if he did bad, he would roast. So instantly we became great friends, and that was pretty much what I did in my spare time towards like the middle of law school. We'd get online and we'd talk a whole bunch of shit to randoms and just play and just like rank up our characters and boost for nukes in Modern Warfare 2. You know, the good old days. Now, eventually Black Ops 1 came out, and as you guys know, they had a theater mode, and we would hit all these cool like clips and like make all these cool games, and he would go in there and make these little montages in theater mode, and he would upload them to this thing called YouTube, and he would name the clips like machinima worthy question mark. And I never understood what that meant, so I finally went and looked it up. And what machinima was like this gaming network that had this channel on YouTube that would post all these really hardcore gaming montages and just like, I guess, achievement hunter type stuff. And through watching that channel, I eventually stumbled upon Call of Duty editors that would make these extremely sick montages with all these artistic effects and all this crazy stuff. I'm like talking like way back in like the Agony days when he was just dominating YouTube and coming out with the latest and greatest Black Ops 1 montages. Back when Optic Predator was hitting like the most crazy insane shots ever, like quickscoping fucking C4s, back when Grizz was tearing shit up. And I just instantly fell in love. Originally, I went to school to become a director. I actually went to a school called UNC Greensboro, which is known for like its film and arts program. It had a really good nursing program too, and that's where I went straight out of high school. And I had set out on a career path to become a director. I really liked film. I really loved movies. Me and my parents and my sister, we all grew up watching movies, and we're never really a big fan of television, but we'd have movie nights, and it really became our thing where we owned a whole bunch of DVDs, and it was just always movies, especially because my parents didn't allow us to have cable in our rooms growing up. But I did have a PlayStation 2, so I could play DVDs, and I would just watch movies in my room all the time. But your boy, young Cumduff, did way too much partying in his first year of school and ended up not doing so well at UNC Greensboro, and ended up transferring back to like a community college, and eventually found accounting, which I found incredibly easy, so I went ahead and got my degree in that from UNC Charlotte. And then the light at the end of the tunnel was coming too quick, so I was like, fuck getting a job, I want to go back to school, so I went to law school, blah 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 blah. But this hobby that I had found in law school really became like my favorite thing to do when I had spare time, and I would make these like montages of tomahawk throws across the map, tomahawks, and I would just name them all these funny things, and I put this extremely dramatic music behind them. Safe to say, I was just in love with YouTube. And eventually this led into me making like let's plays on different video games and making commentaries, and I was uploading every day, and I did this all the way through the end of law school, even afterwards when I was studying for the bar and working, because unlike most of my classmates, after graduation I had to go get a job so I could go pay rent. Now, a lot of these rich kids in law school got to go stay at their parents' house or just instantly had all these connections and to do all these things, so they really got to like study for the bar in like these really cushy atmospheres. Nope, not your boy. Your boy was delivering pizza to make like tips so that I could pay rent and just barely scrape by. But one thing that was really helping me was like the $500 I was getting from YouTube, because although I was not a big YouTuber, I was uploading every day and I was getting like 100 to 200,000 views a month. So basically I was buying groceries at that point with it. And one day, one of my good friends, Jimmy, who I had made all these like videos for, because I had kind of like supplemented my income by learning how to make 3D intros and 3D advertisements and sold them to other YouTubers. If you guys ever seen a lot of my intros back when I used to use intros, intros a whole lot. I used to make these really like creative 3D little mini movies in my mind that are just like 10 second cool introductions to whatever YouTuber. So it'd usually be like this 3D animated character with some 3D text, some stuff like that. And by doing these to make extra income, these videos eventually got their way to Jimmy Ray Chaos X Silencer, who eventually reached out to me to make some of his fake like Easter egg videos. Some of his I think his largest videos on his channel are actually videos that I helped him make. And you guys kind of know the story with me and Jimmy. We eventually started a team called Team Caliber together, and we got to work with all these sponsors through there, and I got introduced to this company called Scuf Gaming. Now, I also got introduced to a company called G Fuel and did ads for them as well, but I started doing these like 3D advertisements for not only Scuf Gaming and G Fuel, but a whole bunch of just random companies in the gaming atmosphere. And that was really where I like made my entrance into the gaming community, because from there I used my legal education to kind of represent certain YouTubers and work with other entertainers so that I could develop their contracts and their connections with sponsors and just basically help them make more income. Unlike today, where there's a whole bunch of like Hollywood agencies helping these YouTubers, you know, make these massive channels, because YouTube has become such a massive financial interest in the entertainment world. Back then, it was just a wild, wild west and no one knew shit. Everyone was just kind of doing whatever. I don't know if you guys know, but most YouTubers aren't extremely well educated. Most people, like me, fell into this industry by accident, even if they are legally versed or really good at reading contracts. We're not Hollywood agents, you know, we're good at making videos, not running entire production companies. So I found my little niche there. And through working with all these companies and making all these ads and stuff like that, I eventually caught the attention of a company called Scuf Gaming. And I made a couple of their controller ads and they were super impressed, and I was really good friends with this guy named Scotty that worked there. And obviously I knew Duncan, who is the CEO of Scuf Gaming, through seeing him at events and things like that. But your boy was still without a job. I was still working for myself, kind of like through YouTube and the things I was doing there, at the same time as studying for the bar and delivering pizza. And it left me in a really shitty living situation. I actually hopped around living with a couple of my different friends. Straight out of law school, I lived with my friend Jamie, and he actually ended up living in like his house as his mom moved out and kind of rented the house to us. So it was actually a really good living situation. So one day he decided he wanted his own furniture, and instead of moving my furniture like into the garage and replacing my furniture with his furniture, he moved it out into the yard in the backyard, not the front yard. But it was raining, and it was kind of this weird situation where I was like, man, I can't believe you would just like take all my shit and put it outside when you could have easily moved it to the garage. It was just one of those weird living situations where it was more his house and he really wanted to set it up how he wanted it, and it made it kind of a really uncomfortable situation. Eventually moved in with my other friend Jonathan, which was the equivalent of jumping out of the pot and into the fire. Now, this is not the Jonathan from my I went to jail video. This is another friend, Jonathan, who I wasn't actually really good friends with. He was a friend from high school. I didn't really go to college with him and really didn't spend a whole lot of time with him while I was in school. So I really didn't even know the guy, save to say the few times I went home while I was in school, but it had been like 6 or 7 years since I was like really good friends with him. Little did I know, this guy was a straight up criminal. Now, I've known him, you know, for the better part of my adult life, because I knew him all throughout high school and all this stuff, and it was just this really friendly and nice but bipolar kid, further multiplied by the fact that his parents were just extremely rich and would buy this dude anything, including the house he was living in, which I ended up renting a room from. Now, me and him never really got along. At this point, I was like pretty much living in my room because I was working all the time. If I wasn't delivering pizza, I was up on the internet grinding that game out, trying to grow on YouTube and manage Team Caliber and just do a million things at once. So I like hardly ever saw the guy. And he used to get really pissed that I would just kind of stay in my room because he really wanted a roommate to help him around the house and to do a whole bunch of stuff with, and I would just stay up in my room. And it got to the point where he would like get mad at me and yell at me for not like helping around the kitchen, because I would never clean anything because I didn't ever use it. Most of the food I either had delivered or I brought home from my job. And I still remember this one fight where he was like, you have to clean the kitchen, you've never cleaned the kitchen. And I went down there and pointed at the sink. I was like, point at the dish that's mine in there. And he couldn't do it. He told me I had to clean the whole entire mess because it was my turn, regardless of the fact that I had not dirtied one single thing in there. And eventually this situation got pretty ugly. And what do I mean by this guy was a criminal? He wasn't a drug dealer or anything crazy like that. He wasn't like running around capping people. But what he did do is he bought and sold cars on Craigslist. And by that, I mean he would buy a cheap piece of shit and like add the smallest like manicured features to it, jack up the price, reset like the speedometer and all the little like alerts on the car, and to sell it to some unsuspecting dumbass on Craigslist. In North Carolina, they have this thing called a floating title, meaning you can buy a car and resell it without ever actually having to put the car in your name. So it really kind of gives these scam artist car salesmen like this legal loophole where they can just like move cars but never actually have the asset in their name, which makes it really easy to just be a total fucking scumbag. But this living situation was impermanent because I was working with the guys at Scuf Gaming doing some like remote stuff. So I was working for them, but like from my house, waiting on a full-time employment offer, which I knew was coming because I was good friends with Scotty and he'd been like putting in the work for me so that the Scuf Gaming company could hire me. And I wasn't going there to do legal work or anything like that. I was going to go work in their marketing department, and really they just wanted to get me into the company because they knew I was smart smart and I was well educated and I was ambitious and they knew I could rise up in the company really well, but they were based in Atlanta and they definitely wanted me to move there. But the whole timing of the thing was kind of sensitive. They wanted to wait like a month or two to see how I would work remotely, and eventually after building a working relationship with me, it was going to have me move down to Atlanta and go work at their offices. Now, I don't know if you guys have heard of Scuf Gaming. They're a very large brand in Call of Duty, as they make like the best custom controller ever made. Like, if you don't play with a scuff or you don't play claw, you're playing Call of Duty at a massive disadvantage, because a scuff allows you to jump around and aim at the same time, because you don't have to take your thumb off the thumbstick to like reload and stuff like that. I'm just gonna assume that you guys all know who Scuf Gaming is. But this roommate situation kept on getting worse and worse and worse, and it finally got down to a day where it like completely snowed in North Carolina. Now, it never snows there, so it's a big deal to us when it snows, and we all like to take our cars out to like parking lots and do donuts and stupid kid shit. And Jonathan, well, he buys and sells cars on Craigslist, so we always had like 5 cars that he would keep like an inventory at the house. So of course we took one out and just went to a local parking lot and did donuts. Now, Jonathan, he doesn't have the greatest track record with cars. He's actually wrecked quite a few of them, and this one was no different. Eventually he like skid too hard, ran right into a curb, and bent the fuck out of a tire. Yes, this is another story where I went out with a friend and he eventually made a 90 degree angle out of his back tire. And he was pretty fucking pissed about this, because this is one of his working assets. This is a car that he bought and was trying to sell. This wasn't his car. But to me it was kind of funny, so I took a picture of it, put it on Twitter. I was like, haha, we thought doing donuts in the snow would be a good idea. And although he had no connection to my YouTube, didn't even have a Twitter, and no one we know was actually gonna see this picture, he got fucking pissed. He thought I was making fun of his poor situation, and he was kind of like this moody bipolar dude, so he just like left me at the gas station we pulled over at. Just left me there. I actually had to call a cab and get a cab back to our shared house, because he literally got that pissed. Like, told me I had to take my own cab home, because obviously we couldn't drive his car. It just sat there until it could come get towed. But he went and got his own cab, and I had to find my own ride. So eventually I made it back to the house, and he's fucking going crazy, throwing my shit everywhere, saying I gotta get the fuck out, like just totally fucking pissed at this. And to be honest, what was really happening here is that my life was starting to get better, because I was working really hard. I was telling him that I was about to move out to get this job. My YouTube was doing well. TK was doing well. I was doing all this traveling to all these events, you know, so I could go support Team Caliber, which basically meant I was going to events to take pictures and buy water bottles for these spoiled rotten bastards. But safe to say, my life was starting to look up really well. I had stopped working at Papa John's because I was earning enough money at home, so I was just generally like doing really well and was like happy. And his life was not doing so well. I don't know where he's at right now, but he was on a downward spiral with all the crazy shit he was doing and his lifestyle and just everything. He's always been this traumatic dude. I'm pretty sure like his life is one of the most terrible situations I think I could ever imagine, despite having extremely wealthy parents. And this jealousy really made him like dislike me, like at a core level, because I was obviously happy and he wasn't. Like, for example, whenever we would get in a fight, he would make fun of me for renting one of his rooms, even though he knew I was moving out like a week later. He'd also brag about how much money he made off selling these cars, and that he didn't even need my rent, that he was just doing me a favor, but at the end of the month, he'd always like come beg me 5 days before the rent was due for my share. This guy was selling like 2 or 3 cars a month, but was buying all this fancy stuff, and we all knew, like our entire group of friends, always knew that it was just his parents giving him money. Despite having every opportunity available to him, because his parents were super rich and could afford to send him to any college in the world, he didn't even finish high school. So if you guys grew up and come super rich, make sure your kids don't ever want for anything, but make sure they work for stuff. Like, don't buy them a brand new car in high school. Give them some beat up piece of shit, even if you can afford to give them a Mercedes. If you spoil them, you're gonna ruin their lives. And even though I had talked to Scuff and gotten the job, and I was actually moving to Atlanta in 3 days, I had to move out of this guy's house. So my whole entire family came. My sister, my brother, my parents, they came to this house, they loaded up all of our cars, and moved me to my brother's house for a total of 2 days before I was to move to Atlanta. And at this point, I'm pretty sure Jonathan was on drugs, because as my whole family's like packing up my car, he's taking my shit and throwing it at my parents' cars. And it's taking everything in me and my dad not to just beat the fucking tar out of this little shit, but we all know that people like that are troubled and we just move on from them. What goes around comes around, and I'm pretty sure life is handing this kid plenty of L's. But yeah, I basically had to move 2 times within a week, and it was absolutely ridiculous. That's how crazy this motherfucker was. And it happened around the very beginning of the month, so he actually ended up keeping my rent, because I paid him like 2 days before that, and I asked him for my rent back, and he was just like, fuck off, you're not getting it, fuck you. He was desperate for money and just a total scumbag. But the story has a happy ending. Eventually, I moved down to Atlanta and got an apartment like right across from the Scuff offices, and I got to work with them, and I was just totally stoked to be working in gaming. Because although I'd gotten all my degrees and really had hoped to work in business and things like that, I had fallen in love with the gaming industry, and I saw it as a massive growth area and just a place with an extreme amount of potential. And it was an industry that I was already pretty well connected in. Most people graduate college or, you know, graduate school and don't really have any connections in the industry or the working field they're going into, save maybe the internship or the externships they did. I was actually pretty well connected in gaming, so I really wanted to work in there and really strove to find my place there. And I was just totally blessed that these beautiful people named Scotty and Duncan and Mike were working at Scuf Gaming and totally believed in me and wanted to hire me on. And as a gamer and kind of a fan of Call of Duty, getting to work at Scuf Gaming is pretty fucking awesome. And when I got there, they treated me like awesome. I got my own office. I got to work directly with their marketing department on all their new products and designing ads. It was just an amazing opportunity at a growing company. I made some great connections there and some even better friends. But during this time, Team Caliber, my YouTube really started to blow up, so I ended up only working at Scuf Gaming for 9 months. And I only really mention that because a lot of people probably see this video and still think I'm working there. No, I actually quit working there right around when I hit like 400 and 500,000 subscribers. And my income from YouTube was growing at a rate that I felt like if I was going to really take advantage of this opportunity on YouTube to build my own brand, that I should probably quit my main job and spend all my time working on YouTube. Because while I was working at Scuf, you know, I was a grinder my whole life. I was still uploading daily while I was working at Scuf. So my days were really waking up at like 8 or 9, going and putting a full day at the office. So I would work there like 8 hours, come home at like 5 or 6, film a video, edit it, and get it up at like 9 or 10. So yeah, I've been uploading my videos late, like literally my whole YouTube career. My videos have never gone up like around 5 or 6 like every other YouTuber. My videos are like 10, 9, 11, just constantly. And you would think after I quit working at Scuf and solely dedicated my life to YouTube that my uploads would start getting earlier, but nope, I had other responsibilities as well. During this time, I become the sole owner of Team Caliber and was doing a whole bunch of stuff with that and a whole bunch of other like businesses that I'm diversified in because I'm a busybody. I like doing a whole lot of shit. I remember being bored in high school and I hated that feeling and I haven't been bored ever since. I've been literally swamped where every single minute of my day counts since I graduated. And I wouldn't live life any other way. Now, this is a little known fact because it wasn't until recently that I reached out to Scuf to ask if I could make one of these videos and kind of say that I work there. Because although it's not like a secret, you know, who works at what companies, because I'm a YouTuber and, you know, I have my own social media and I don't want my opinions or actions representing that of Scuf, obviously I wanted to wait a while to even ask them if I could tell everybody that that was my first job and how appreciative I was to Duncan and Scotty for believing in me and giving me a shot. Because your first job is like extremely important because you have like nothing really to offer that a whole bunch of other people don't already have to offer as well. And they really gave me a shot and I took full advantage of it, as you can see, and I've been working my ass off ever since. I worked at restaurants for tips for the better part of my life and there was no way I was ever doing that again. So if you guys are wanting to work in gaming and this is really where you want to end up, my only real advice to tell you is to one, never give up on it because this is a massively growing industry. It's the largest entertainment industry in the world. Yes, we've passed cable TV, we've passed major sports, and we've passed movies. All of Hollywood is completely dwarfed by the gaming industry. But with that being said, I'm also going to say get your education, because although I didn't end up working for like another company, I use my education every single day and would have never gotten the opportunities I got, would have never been given the chances that I got, would have never had the doors open for me that were if I didn't have an education and could prove that I was an intelligent person. And not even so much intelligence, really, school just shows a future employer or anyone that you were going to want to and believe in you and invest in you that, hey, I'm grown up enough to go show up somewhere for 4 years and put that much effort into my future. Because that's what school really does, because you don't learn anything like that you're really going to use in your job unless you're like highly trained in a very specific area. Really, the only thing college does is teach you how to learn and how to learn quickly, how to communicate with people and show other people that you're grown up enough to actually dedicate yourself both financially and time-wise to your future. And I'll give that same advice to YouTubers. You know, you see a lot of YouTubers hit 100K, 200K and they quit their job and fully dedicate themselves to YouTube. I'll tell you, I didn't quit my main job until my YouTube was like earning double that of what my real job was making me. It wasn't until then I felt safe enough to move over to this. And really, it's not even safe because, you know, you work for yourself, your whole entire income is dependent on you. So if you're in that handful of YouTubers that's contemplating ending their normal career to pursue this, just, I would say, wait as long as possible. Do both as long as you can. Because although YouTube is home to a lot of success stories, it's home to even more people that tried it and couldn't do it for a living. Just like any non-traditional industry, whether it's sports or entertainment, you get what I'm talking about. So I guess that calculation is different for everybody, but I definitely waited to the absolute last minute. And when I quit Scuf, I didn't even quit entirely. I didn't like go from working 40 hours a week to just completely being gone. I actually stayed on there part-time like for 3 months so that I could finish out my like employment contract. And obviously, I wasn't so easily replaceable. I was pretty awesome. I'm just kidding. I just said that just in case Duncan or Scotty are watching this video, they might have gotten a smile out of it. But no, everybody at Scuf Gaming, especially Duncan and Scotty, were extremely supportive over my decision to go continue to do YouTube because they knew that's where my heart was. When I had my final like like meeting with Duncan to discuss me leaving Scuf Gaming. He told me he always knew that I was going to go do that, and he knew that's where my future was and wanted to do everything he could to help support me in that. And also told me if I ever wanted to come back, I'd always have a job there, which I can't tell you how much I appreciate, because, you know, working for yourself is, although extremely rewarding, it's also extremely stressful because you don't have a safety net. Well, my safety net is the friends and the relationships I've made here in this gaming industry, and I'm proud to say that I know some of the coolest fucking people that work here. But yeah, that's the story of my first job, and I'm assuming, like most people, it's a really hectic time in your life because you're just finishing school or just beginning your adult working life and things like that, so I feel like I had a pretty traumatic start to my professional career. I will tell you that delivering pizza while I had a law degree, while I was busy studying for the bar 9 hours a day and doing a million other things, is probably one of the most humbling experiences that I've ever had. And although it was pure hell, I wouldn't trade it for anything because it made me every inch of the man I am today. So in summary, I'm going to leave you guys with an extremely corny saying, and that's never give up on your dreams, because believe it or not, hard work will give you anything you want, especially in this country and especially this day and age of humanity. You work extremely hard for something, eventually you'll get it. There will be people that will get it sooner, that will get certain opportunities and certain breaks that you won't get, but if you literally stay at it and you work not only hard but smart, I will promise you that you might not get exactly what you want, but you will get what you need. All right, hope you guys enjoy the video. I'll see you tomorrow.